Dear students, today we will study about the second part of the pathology portion. And here we can discuss about the plant diseases you have to study in your syllabus. So in your syllabus there are four diseases which are categorized as some viral diseases, bacterial diseases and fungal diseases. And
coming to the class, the first disease we are studying is leaf mosaic disease of tapioca. And actually this is one of the worst diseases of tapioca, that is cassava, widespread in Kerala and other tapioca cultivating parts of India, and also some foreign countries like South African countries and Brazil. There also we can see this disease is very prominent. And the pattern of our study related to this disease is, first we will discuss about its identification symptoms, then causative organism and what are the control measures. And about this exam point of view, you can expect four mark questions and also 2 and 1 mark question. Sometimes 1 mark question, that is what is the causative organism of leaf mosaic disease of tapioca, and like that we can expect. And some 2 mark questions, what are the symptoms. But 4 mark question, you should write about the symptoms, causative organism and control measures completely. And first disease, that is leaf mosaic disease of tapioca. So already I explained the conditions of this disease, and then we will discuss about the symptoms, that is how we can identify the presence of disease. So when we are observing the tapioca plant, that is Manicotes esculentus, we can see pale yellow or pale green patches which are appearing as a mosaic pattern. We can see in leaves here, we can see that mosaic pattern. So this is the one of the important identification symptoms of the this particular disease. So leaves then twisted, distorted and stunted, and the leaves becomes as a result dry or die off. The leaflets have localized mosaic pattern. Heavily infected plant is distorted, that means completely shriveled condition, that is dried up and retarded and dwarfed. And here one carrier organism is there in between. It's a viral disease, so it is with a carrier organism. Here the carrier organism is the white fly, that is Bemisia tabaci. Here we can see this white fly. It's very small but white in color. And while you are just walk through this tapioca plantations, there we can see this white flies, that is Bemisia tabaci, and is the carrier of this tobacco mosaic virus. And transmission is through their feeding habits, normally inhabiting on the leaves. And while ingesting the tissue, it normally transmits virus also. So causative organism is tapioca mosaic virus. So causative organism is not Bemisia, it is only a carrier. And in which way the spreading of the disease we can see, that is the severity of cassava mosaic disease is influenced by environment factors such as wind, rainfall, plant density and temperature. If field is with a congested mass of this plants, then the severity is more. So the viruses are transmitted through infected cuttings sometimes and by white fly, and the spread of the virus largely depend on the vector population. Suppose the white fly is more, we can see the spreading of disease is also more. And how we can control this disease, and that is it's a viral disease, so there is no treatment, and there is no recovery percentage for this plants. controlling the insect is best option. Then sanitation practices like removing and burning the infected places is effective. Then the proper use of cultural instruments, that is disease free instruments we can use. Then changing it, that is before plowing the land, we can disinfect the plowing machine. And what are the items or machinery we are using, you can sanitize them. Then the proper use of then that is the next one is changing the planting season is also effective. That is in just after the rainy season we can see maximum growth of this Mimesia tabaci. So if suppose we are using disease free cuttings, and also sometimes can change the planting time, and then also we can effectively control the spreading of this disease. So tapioca planted after the beginning of the rainy season is less susceptible to the disease. That is at the time of the time the plant is not grown well, and that's why we can escape from this Mimesia flies. Use of resistant varieties such as S13110 and H97. It's nothing but these are the hybrids. These are the accession numbers of the hybrid plants. Okay, and this is the method through this pattern we should study all the diseases. That is, first we will discuss about the general characteristics of this disease. Then what are the identification symptoms? Then the mode of spreading. Then how it we can control them. Then next one is citrus canker, and it's actually a bacterial disease. Here citrus canker, that is canker means the dried patches on this plant as well as on this lemon surface. And citrus canker, that is the citrus canker is a bacterial disease, first important point, and is it is widespread in all citrus growing areas of the world, especially India, China, Europe, USA, all the places we can see this bacterial disease. And this disease in still serious condition in India, China and Japan. All other countries are using disease resistant varieties of citrus now. Okay, coming to how symptoms, how we can recognize this disease. So the disease affects all the above ground parts of the tree, that is stem, leaf, leaves, then flowers, fruits, all the aerial parts is infected, but most susceptible are the leaves, twigs and fruits. Okay, that is susceptible means more it is more vulnerable to that disease, it is not resistant, and it particularly produces scabby lesions. First it is not wart like, first the disease symptom is appearing like lesions, that is water lodged burnings on the surface of the fruits, and thereby reduces their market value. Suppose this lemon is with the black or brown patches, that is normally it will reduce the economical value of that fruit. The lesions first appear on host surface as small watery translucent spots, which increase in size and then turned into dark green with the progress of the disease. Okay, and the host tissues surrounding the spots become raised. Here we can see this raised appearance. Okay, then become raised, resulting the spots to develop a convex surface. The central region of the spots gradually turns light brown and spongy and breaks down, producing a crater like appearance. That is normally in this area. First it this wart like appearance is convex, in appearance. Then when the disease is prolonged, the center portion, here this leaf surface, we can see that center portion is dark, more dark colored, and there that area becomes spongy and depressed. So it like a crater or ditch appearance. Okay, and with age the spots become corky and brown, sometimes pinkish, then cankerous appearance, wart like appearance. On the leaves, the lesions appear first on the lower surface. The lesions on the twigs and fruits very similar to those of leaves, and then on fruits the lesions often coalesce, forming very conspicuous. That means the lesions if it is in contact, it becomes large lesions. Okay, and irregular patches on rough, scabby and raised areas. What are the, what is the causal organism? So it is a bacterial disease, and it is caused by Pseudomonas citrae. Okay, Pseudomonas citrae. Citrae means citrus fruit, and it is that particular species is Pseudomonas species is infecting citrus plants. That's why species name citrae. And the organism is rod shaped monotrichous bacteria with a yellow water soluble pigment, and it is an aerobic bacteria. Okay, these are all the, just you can write the name itself, only one line is enough, that is Pseudomonas citrae is a bacteria. Then how we can control the disease? It is rather very difficult to control the disease, and some methods we can implement because it is bacterial disease. Good sanitation, that is destruction of all affected trees by burning, then pruning of infected parts, particularly during dry season, and reduce source of inoculum. That is, if the a lemon tree is infected, and even though with the disease also it is flowering and fruiting, so sometimes the farmers will leave that plant as such, and it causes severe problem. If any infected plant is there, we are not burning the whole plant, then we should cut the or prune the infected parts. Okay, then spraying fungicides. Even though it is a bacterial disease, fungicides we can use, that is for example Bordeaux mixture, lime sulfur, like that. Then this spraying must done with during 3 months, that is during the first 3 months of the development of fruits. Then after 3 months likewise you should spray, and use, the better thing is use this disease resistant varieties. Okay, and it will give good results. Then the third disease is blast disease of paddy, and this figure you can see this, here we can see this diamond shaped, extended diamond shaped patches, then it is blast disease of paddy. So it is a fungal disease, and it is one of the commonest widespread and severe disease of paddy, normally present all over the world. And we can see over this disease is reported nearly 70 countries, rice growing countries of the world, and it is considered as the major threat or problem of rice production in Japan, Taiwan, USA and India. So the disease is more severe in areas of high humidity and high rainfall. Okay, then how we can recognize this disease, that is what are the symptoms? So this rice blast affects the leaves, on which it causes diamond shape, that is identification symbol, the patches is with this extended diamond shaped appearance, and reddish brown lesions with reddish to brown borders. Here we can see this center portion is slightly pale or white, and we can see magenta borders. Okay, then blast also affects the leaf collar, which is where it may kill the entire leaf.
that is lower portions. The disease is more and it normally that area decays. And the fungus also attacks the panicle neck node. That means there are, when the plant flowers, we can see this panicle spikes, we can see this spikelets, and at that area it will infect, and as a result the whole flower panicle, that inflorescence, perishes. Okay, and it is neck, it is called the neck rot or neck blast or the panicle blast stage of the disease. And if infection of the panicle neck occurs yearly, the grains do not fill and the panicle remains erect. That means normally when the seeds are ready, normally this panicle normally appear as in pendant position, okay, due to the weight of the seed. And in Malayalam it is called padiru. If it is padiru, means it is weightless, so the panicle is erect. If the panicle neck is infected late, the grains become partially filled and becomes the weight of the that is the weight of the grain. The base of the panicle breaks and panicle droops. Then also, that is in partially filled seeds, that panicle, then also it breaks because the lower portion of the panicle is decayed. Sometimes only parts of the panicle and some glumes become infected and develop brown or black spots. Then also the economical value of that rice reduces. Here and there, suppose we are inspecting the rice, some grains are dark brown and some dried condition. That is due to this partial disease infection. Then what is the causal organism? So the rice blast fungus pathogen, here it is fungus disease, it is known as Spiracularia oryzae, but is indistinguishable from the other species, that is Spiracularia grisea, which causes grey leaf spot of the other grasses, not for the oryzae sativa. Then the fungus produces simple grey conidiophores that bear terminal pear shaped, mostly two septate conidia. Here the conidia is two septate. The fungus produces several toxins like pyricularin. You can remember this name because it is related to the causative organism. Pyricularia oryzae produces the toxins pyricularin and picolinic acid that seems to contribute to the development of the rice blast. And due to the presence of these toxins, normally this tissue of the rice plant perishes or decays. And what are the control measures? Control of rice blast in areas of low blast pressure is based primarily on the planting resistant cultivars. That is, you should plant hybrid varieties with the disease resistance of this blast disease. Then the blast, where the blast epidemics are common and severe, in addition to plant resistant cultivars, which must change frequently, control is aided by early planting. Even though we are using this disease resistant varieties, that we know that sometimes this pathogen may mutate it. So that's why, anyway, if suppose we are using this resistant varieties also, keep nitrogen fertilizers to minimum necessity and using fungicides. Okay, fungicides use regularly, and use this nitrogen fertilizers minimally. That will increase the growth of fungus. Okay, that's why many fungicides have been used with a varying effectiveness over the years. Most recently, systemic fungicides which inhibit penetration by the fungus through interference with the melanin production, and it's up, and as a result what happens, the fungus infection means oppressorium must be there and it will protrude through the stomata, and if we are using the systemic fungicides, it will arrest the formation of oppressorium, and as a result we can control the infection. An experimental pre-plant soil application, that is before the plantation or sowing of the rice seedlings, we can treat the land with a silicone containing basic ground granulated blast furnace slag, that is it is like a chamber, and which is collected from blast furnace slag. It is collected from silicone furnaces, and to reduce the rice blast and in some rice blast of some areas. So these are the control measures of this blast disease of paddy. So it's considered as a very serious disease. It may lead to famine. Okay, because it is infecting the staple food of our country. Then the next disease is root wilt of coconut, that is kaattu veezha in Malayalam, and coconut root wilt disease is a non-lethal debilitating disease, because it is not so severe, but it affects the production of the coconut nuts and first, like that of the previous diseases, here also we can see the what are the identification symptoms. Here this photograph itself, it is evident that, and it is with this disease. Okay, the symptoms, the root wilt affected coconut are susceptible to diseases such as leaf rot and pests. That is the reason. Once the root wilt disease is occurred, normally altogether the immune system of the coconut tree reduces, and as a result it will get other diseases like leaf rot and the infection of pests such as rhinoceros beetle, comban jelly, rhinoceros beetle and red palm weevil increases. Okay, and chance of confusing the pest and disease symptoms with the root wilt disease, that may be one of the main problem, that is some of the symptoms are resembling that of the pest attack. Then what is a causative organism? The disease is caused by phytoplasma. It's a phytoplasma, that it is actually a bacteria, and it is a vascular limited pathogen, that is it is inhabiting in the tissue area. Insect vector, namely lace bug, and here also one carrier organism is there, that is lace bug and plant hopper, transmit this disease. Then what are the control measures? Application of magnesium sulfate at 1 kg per plant per annum. That means in 1 year you should apply or keep 1 kg magnesium sulfate per plant. Reduces the yellowing symptom. Here we can see this yellowing symptom. Then borax mixture is applied for borax is applied for boron deficiency. Because that yellowing of plant may be due to this deficiency disease, trace element, that is borax. Okay, for leaf control, cut the rotten portions of the spindle and the adjacent to innermost fully opened leaves, and pour 300 ml of fungicide solution, that is in the topmost that is cluster of leaves. Send young leaves must cut and cut open that area, and through that area you can pour 300 ml of fungicide solution. Then mulching and drip irrigation are essential. Here we can see this mulching, that is the lower portion is completely covered by coconut husk or dried leaves or anything like that. That is the mulching process, and it reduces the chances of root wilt. Okay, and these are the four symptoms of your syllabus. It's practical point of view, you should identify, suppose you should, that at the time of practical exams
you should add it. Well, suppose the tapioca leaf is exhibited, you should write the name of the disease and causative organism and control measures. Like that, you should identify the four diseases. And it is very easy, this portion. That is, suppose the citrus canker, that is the lime or lemon with this black color, or dark color, or reddish yellow patches. Then you can very well identify it is a citrus canker. This disease is citrus canker. Like that, the leaf will show with these patches. Then only one paddy disease is there, so it is very easy to identify. One disease you should study in your syllabus, that's why. Then coconut leaf with this rusty or dried portions, then also you can identify the disease. Okay, and these are the four diseases you should study. Try to identify the class, and if you are having any doubt, please ask. Thank you.